Hi, my name is Edray Goins, and I'm professor of mathematics at Pomona College. When I was younger, I wasn't really that interested in mathematics. I was actually interested more in physics. I was really interested in how the world around me worked, just how things moved. I lived not too far away from Los Angeles International Airport, which meant that I saw airplanes flying over all the time. And I was just really interested in why they were up in the air, how they moved. So my interest in physics came in from a very early age, probably when I was about 6 years old or so. I thought mathematics was actually a totally useless field. I really didn't understand what math was. I didn't understand what mathematicians did. It wasn't until my first year of college that I actually found a real interest in mathematics. It's when I went to the bookstore one day and saw a book with a funny title, Introduction to Number Theory. I had no idea what number theory was, picked up the book, fell in love with it, and I've been a mathematician ever since. I wasn't really sure I wanted to be a mathematician until I started graduate school. As an undergraduate, I still kept my interest in physics. I was a physics major. I took as many physics classes as I could. I was a closeted mathematician. Mathematics was something that I loved to do, but I was actually afraid to tell people I was a mathematics major. Again, I really thought math was just a totally useless, self-indulgent field. I decided to go to grad school at a school where I could go back and forth between the physics and math departments. It really wasn't until my second year of graduate school, when I was getting my PhD, that I decided mathematics is not only what I wanted to do, but I was ready to declare it to the whole world. I work in the intersection of number theory and algebraic geometry. Maybe the easiest way I can explain it is by using the two phrases, or the two words, algebraic geometry. Algebra is exactly what we're used to from high school and even earlier. You have arithmetic, like adding things together, multiplying things together. You even have a slight generalization of that, this concept of solve for x. You have these abstract variables in which you can do your arithmetic. And geometry is also like what we expect from high school. That's, you have circles and spheres, and you're trying to draw lines and understand different shapes. What I like to do is combine the two of these together, that you're literally doing algebra, but you're using geometry to do it. Maybe some of you might remember the ruler compass constructions or the straight edge compass constructions that you did in junior high school. This is where you might have a ruler and you might have a pen or a pencil, and you're trying to draw things, you have a protractor, you're trying your best to kind of draw circles and arcs. And really what you're doing is algebraic geometry. You have numbers, which is what's on the ruler, and you have geometry, which is your protractor and straight edge, and you're somehow trying to do all of this together. You're trying to do things like bisect angles, or maybe trying to construct various arcs of certain lengths. This is pretty much what I do, but in a very abstract sense. I like to use computers when I work on things, trying to draw objects in three dimensions. I also like to solve some pretty nasty equations. Some equations that I deal with can be 3-4 pages long. They can be really, really horrendous equations. But at the end of the day, I really just like combining all of these things together. Probably the most frustrating difficulties I've come across are people who think that they know what I'm capable of, and they limit their concepts of what they think I'm able to do. This not only happens when you're a professor, unfortunately, but this definitely happened to me when I was much, much younger, you know, elementary school, junior high school, so on and so forth. I remember many times being involved with summer programs for elementary school kids where we would learn about insects and maybe some other things that we might see in the backyard. Now, I remember at one point in one of the programs, the students all went outside for like, you know, lunchtime or what have you. I decided to stay in the room because I was very interested in these insects and what were around the room. I must have been about 8 years old at the time. And I remember walking around the room, looking at the cages, not poking my fingers in the cages, but just looking in them to see what was there. And the teacher was following very closely behind me. And every time I would get to the cage to look at it again, I wouldn't have any of my fingers close to it. She would say, "Don't touch that. Don't get so close to it." And it was really frustrating that there, I really had an interest in what was happening, but she, I think, thought that I was just this troublemaker kid that was going to mess up her room. I can tell you lots and lots of stories like that where teachers just thought either I wasn't capable of doing something, maybe I wasn't good enough of doing something. I eventually had to realize for myself, I can't change other people's opinions of me. I can only keep track of how I view myself. So as much as this has happened over the years, I've just tried to really focus on what I know I'm capable of and not let what other people think about me dictate what I'm able to do. Definitely my proudest accomplishment is being a professor here at Pomona College. I know that that sounds a little bit strange. You might think that it's maybe some theorem that I've proven or some award that I've gotten. Really it's being able to come back here to where I grew up, coming back to Southern California. You know, when I was younger, I'd always thought about going off to get maybe a PhD, to be a college professor, to be a famous scientist, and so on and so forth. But you eventually come back to this idea that you want to be around to help your family, and you want to be around to be around your cousins and uncles and aunts and people that you grew up with. And it's actually really nice that now, after being away for so many years and having a career and getting myself established, that I'm able to come back and help take care of my parents. I'm able to see high school friends. I'm actually able to go back to my high school and junior high school and help out with things there. It's really nice that I'm able to come back here to the area where I grew up, to really try to be a role model for some of the people that I grew up with. Also, I'm really happy that I'm able to be around colleagues that I really love talking to every day. I'm around, I think, some of the world's best students. You know, I feel that I'm very fortunate that not only am I able to teach them, but I'm also able to learn from them as well. And this is something where, you know, it wasn't a fluke that I came back here to Pomona. It really took a long time and a lot of work and a lot of conversations with different people. But it's something that I'm very proud of now, that I'm able to be a professor here at Pomona College. You know, there were different people over my life who were either inspirational or influential. One person in particular I do want to mention is a friend of mine when I was an undergraduate. I don't really know if I should mention his name because I know that he doesn't really like to be discussed publicly. He was one of the few Black students at my undergraduate institution. When I got there to campus, I was one of the few Black students on campus. There were 14 of us out of a class of about 200 freshmen that came in 1990. And there were only maybe about 30, 35 Black students total of a campus of about 2,000 students. So it was a very, very small group that was there in general. So when I came in, of course, I was wondering where the other Black students were, what was happening with the culture on campus. And it was almost impossible to find anyone. Well, there was one Black student in particular who was very popular on campus, very visible, and he befriended me very early on. In fact, he was always encouraging to me. He was one of the only Black physics majors on campus, which of course really meant a lot since that's what I was also majoring in. And this guy really was very motivating to me for the whole 4 years I was there as my undergraduate. At one point, you know, he and I only overlapped for 1 year. He was a senior when I was a freshman, and he actually got a major award during his senior year. And of course, that made a major influence on me. That here it was one of the few Black students. He was a physics major. He was getting a major award at graduation. Well, he went off to grad school for a couple of years, and then we reconnected again during my junior year. He came back saying that he had a lot of negative experiences about grad school, and unfortunately, he had decided to drop out of grad school. So you might think that that's a really depressing story and that, you know, here it is that this great person is not doing very well. Well, actually hearing him discuss that really motivated me to be very careful as to my choice of where to go to grad school, who I wanted to have as an advisor, being aware of some of the difficulties that I was going to see going off to graduate school. But even saying all of that, he was still incredibly supportive when he came back to visit campus during my junior years and senior years. And even to this day, now that I've moved back to Southern California, he's still a very kind, influential friend. And the funny thing is that, you know, we only overlapped in school by 1 year, but he was just so influential and just really how encouraging he was over the years, just saying a lot of things to me behind the scenes when I really needed to hear it, that he was certainly one of the most influential people that I've ever had in my life. I would like to share some words. There's a quote by Maya Angelou that I often tell myself, especially when I'm feeling either down or depressed about things. And it goes, "You will suffer many defeats, but you must not be defeated." simply put, there's going to be a lot of frustrations that you're going to have. There could be professors that are going to be negative. There could be students that will certainly think that you're not going to make it. There might be times you're going to fail exams and even wonder whether you should even be in this game altogether. But I think at the end of the day, you have to look at yourself and really ask, is this what you want to do? Do you think that you're good enough to make it through all of this? And this is something that I have to tell myself on a daily basis. I try my best not to think about what others have to say about me, but it's really, do I have faith in myself? So yeah, there's gonna be a lot of frustrating times. And unfortunately, it's just the way that the world works. But you still have to look to yourself to know that at the end of the day, you are going to make it.